Welcome to Tech Primers. In this video, we are going to see how to use Hibernate entity mappings. If you had seen my previous video, I showed you how to use Hibernate with MySQL inside a Spring Boot application. So in this particular example, we are going to take forward the same application and see how to use mappings across tables. So previously in the example, you would have noticed that we created a table called users. So what we are going to do is we are going to create another table and see how we can use different types of mappings, like let's say one-to-one mapping or one-to-many mapping or many-to-one mapping. So let's see how to use these mappings in Hibernate. Let's see with an example, right? So I have the same application which I had shown you in the previous video. So you can take the link of the GitHub repository for this particular project and then proceed from there. So I'm using the same project which I had pushed for the previous example. So let's see how we can change that particular project. Okay. So why is it having an issue? Oh, sorry. Yeah. So yeah, we have the main, we have the models, repositories and resources. Right, so what we were doing here is we were using get mappings and we were updating some data using the get itself because I wanted to show it for simplicity. But yeah, let's now write a new repository, right? Let's now write a new user. So previously we had a table called users with the test database. So let's write something for contacts, right? So let's write a users contact. Okay, so let's write a new entity. So I'm going to say mark this as entity. So this is coming from JPA and I'm going to say what is the table information. So let's say the table name is users underscore contact. And the database is same test. Right. So now what fields do we need? So let's consider ID and then phone number, let's say, right? Okay, so I'm going to create some getters and setters for these. So we don't have to mark anything for the column names because let's retain the same name. So if you want to change the column names, then you can use add column and then you can give those names. So you can give a name here. For this particular column, you can give different names. I'll show you with an example. So I'm going to mark this as generated value. I'm going to say the strategy as auto. So let it generate the values automatically. Same way for users, previously we did not generate it automatically. Let's mark this as generated value. So I'm going to show you some way to create them automatically. So if you mark these annotations, so it will automatically create a primary key and it will automatically assign that. So it will increment the integer one by one. So Hibernate will maintain a sequence number and then it happens one to it every time you do an insert. So what we have done here is we have created another table called users contact. Okay, and then we have an ID and a phone number. Okay, so let's create a corresponding repository and finally I'll show you how to link these two. So let's go and create all the ceremonial files which we need, right? So I'm going to say users contact repository. So using this, we are going to retrieve data from the database. So I'm going to say JPA repository. So we are going to use Spring JPA. Users info, users contact. And then I'm going to say primary key as integer. Okay, and this is an interface. Right, now let's write another REST endpoint for users contact. So this is users contact resource. So I'm going to mark this as REST controller. I'm going to say request mapping as REST slash users contact. And I'm going to write REST endpoint get mapping public. We need a list of users contact. Get users contact. right? So let's do this. Okay, so now we need the repository. So we need to inject the repository users contact. Right, so I'm going to say return users contact dot find all. So find all is going to give all the data. So now we need to auto wire this, right? We can do an auto wire or we can do a construction injection. So in Spring latest version, construction injection is supported. So you don't have to auto wire this, it automatically gets auto wired. So you don't have to add auto wired annotation. You can add it, but Spring automatically does construction constructor injection by default in the latest version of Spring. Okay, so what we have done is, okay, we have exposed this endpoint and we are getting the data. Now this is going to get only the data in this particular table, right? So now we want to link users contact table with the users table, right? So this users table is going to store some information about the user, and users contact is going to store the phone number. Okay, so what we need to do is we need to create relationship between the users table and the users contact. So what we are going to do here is we are going to create entity mapping, basically a relationship between the users and the users contact. So what we are saying is I want users, right? So I'll add some getters and setters. Okay, so we have done that. Now also we didn't create a constructor. If you notice, we need to create a constructor which is empty for Habanet, right? So what we have done is we have created a users now. So how do we populate this users is we are going to tell Habanet to populate that automatically. So what we are going to do is we are going to map this as 1-to-1. So what Habanet does is it's going to create a one-on-one mapping between users contact and users table. So these two entities are now mapped one-on-one. And what we are going to say here is join these two tables using some columns. So what column do we need to join with, right? So here we have an ID. And here also we have an ID. So we are going to, let's say I don't want to create a new ID in the users contact table. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the existing ID field to be used as a primary key, and I will use the same key field to be mapped to the users table. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to say map the column in this particular table. So the name refers to the value which is there in this particular table, and map it to reference column, which is nothing but the referenced entity, which is users. So map it to users of this particular, sorry, ID of this particular users table. So that's what we are telling Habanet now. So we are telling that join the column with ID and ID. Okay, in fact we don't have to do that because it's all there, but ideally I would prefer you to add it so that you can easily identify, okay, this ID is getting mapped to this. Because what happens is when you start debugging your code, right, it gets haywire and you end nowhere. So that is what I have seen in production, and that is what I have noticed. So it's better to use the names and reference column so that you directly know that, okay, this particular table is mapped with the ID of this table with the ID of that table. But if you are a pro and you feel that, okay, it's not required, go ahead with that. It should be okay. Okay, now what I'm going to do is, so we have a REST endpoint here for get mapping. So I'm going to add the REST endpoint as all. So this will return all. Now I'll add a REST endpoint to just inject data, right? So I will inject some dummy data. Let's say we update. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to pass some, let's say name alone. Okay. For simplicity, I'll just pass the name just to show you. I don't want to type everything so that it will be quicker for you to, and you know, this is about the Habanet only, right? I don't want to do post and get examples and stuff like that. So that is why I'm just using the get itself. In general, don't use get for updating stuff. So we're going to return the list of users. I'm going to say update, and this is a path variable, right? So I'm going to say path variable final and string name. So this is a name, so I'm going to say name. Okay, so what I'm going to do here is we need to create objects, right? We have created pojos. Now we need to use these pojos to create to set the values, right? So one tip I recently learned from some person is that whenever you write setters, we write void method, right? Methods, right? So let's say I'm going to create users object. So what we do is you say new users, and then you say users dot set name, team name, let's say development, and then you say salary, let's say 1000 or 10,000, right? Dot set name, let's say for our say Kids YouTube. Okay, so we have a team name, salary, and name. So what we see here is we are using the same object to do setters every time, right? Which is like a duplication, and it's like there are chances that if you copy paste this into some other file, so we do always do copy paste, right? Like we copy paste from some place or the other. So when you do copy paste, there are chances that you forget to rename one object or something like that. So what we can do is we can go and change these to use builder patterns. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to say return the same object, and I'm going to return the instance of the same object. So what I'm doing is I'm just saying that return the same object, don't do anything else, I'll just take care of it. Okay, it's just going to do this. It's not going to harm us, but the code will be neat. So I'll show you how neat it is before and after. So we have done all the setters. Okay, let's do that for the user's contact as well. Okay. Okay, so what we have done is we have returned everything. So now if you see, we can use the builder patterns and change this code into something like this. Something like this. So if you see here, the same object, we are using the same object to iterate it and set it something. So if you see the latest reactive programming or stuff like that, so they use similar builder patterns so that you have a single object and you iterate it over that. So because we are doing the same thing here, but this is like neat. This is like less error prone compared to what is used here. So let's say you had another object called users 1 or 2 and you are trying to do something there. So it's easier this way. Okay, it's just another tip, nothing else. So there is no one saying that okay you should use only this, but yeah, that's another nice way which I learned recently. So now let's create the user's contact. Okay, in the user's contact I'm just going to set the phone number 11111. Okay, and inside the user's contact what we need to do is we need to, so basically I can move this user's contact here down, right, so that we can use the builder pattern now. So we can say set users, I want to set the user object, right? So now what we are going to do is we are going to use the repository to save this object. So we are going to save the user's contact. Right, finally I'm going to return, I'm just going to query the whole table and then just send it. So just for our simplicity purpose, and so what we are doing here is we are going to create a user information with name as YouTube, salary as 10,000, development is the team name, and also we are creating a user's contact with some phone number, and we are setting that in the user's contact. Okay, so notice, if you notice that in the user's contact what we have done is we have created a link between the users table and the contact, users contact table. However, if you see this one-on-one annotation, so we have just used it for querying everything, right? So there is an option called cascade. So you have to set the cascade as all so that whenever we try to update this user's contact, okay, with the user's information, it will try to cascade the information into the user's table as well. So if you don't mark this as cascade all, we won't be able to update it, okay? So that is what we are going to mark it as here. So we are saying that okay, if somebody sets a user's information on this particular entity, update this user's information as well. So that is what we are doing here. I think we are set now. Let's meanwhile, there is an option to recreate tables. So I'm just going to say create and draw, so that let's recreate the table structure. I don't know what was the state of the table structure because I've been playing around in that database. So let's recreate that table structure so that we will have clean data to work on. So we have two REST endpoints, one for all, one for update with the name. So whatever name, actually, if you see, I am not passing the name. Let's pass the name, right? I'll restart it again. So that every time we create a new object, at least the name, let the name change, right? So that for we can check with the new data. Basically, I can even do a post mapping with a JSON, but yeah, I just wanted to make it simple so that we concentrate more on the Hibernate part rather than the JSON REST endpoint. So the process is coming up. So if you notice here, it has dropped both the tables and recreated them again. Okay, I have SQL Pro. If I see the structure of the table, right, does not exist. Why is that here? So I'll just refresh it. Yeah, so if you see here, there are two tables, users and users contact. So these are the table structures. One, users contact as ID and phone number, and users table as ID, name and salary and team name. If you see the content of these table are empty. Okay, so let's go ahead and use the REST endpoints. Right, so localhost, we have users contact, right? So we initially have an all REST endpoint which is going to return all the data which is there in the database. Now there is nothing because we didn't insert anything. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to insert some data. If you notice here, I just call the update REST endpoint with a name, and if you notice, this is the data which is created. If you notice, the ID and the phone number are coming from the users contact POJO. If you notice, this is the one ID and the phone number is coming, and we had a users. And if you see the REST, the JSON message inside the users, we have the information of the users which got inserted, right? And also let's go to the database and check what is the content, right? So if you notice, the data is inserted automatically. If you don't do the cascade all, this is going to give a transient error, so the information of users will not be cascaded to the users table. And if you see the queries, what Hibernate does is Hibernate first does a select query and it inserts the value. If you see here, it inserts the contact information, phone number, and then it inserts the users information as well, and then it also adds the primary key to that. Okay, so let's update some new values, right? Peter, Sam. If you see here, all these are one-on-one mappings. So basically, so when I go and say all, this is going to give all the information. Okay, so now let's say I want to have a different column name. So if you notice, both the tables have the same column name ID. Let's say I want to have a different column name. I want to have the column name as user underscore ID in this table, but I want to retain the same ID here. In that case, what should I do is I need to go to this particular referenced column. So basically, name is nothing but the column which is referred in this particular table, and reference column is where we are going to reference ID with that. So what we are going to say is map this ID of this column to user ID of that column. It happens, right? Most of the time there are 2-3 tables which we have in our code which are having different column names, but you want to link those with a ID, common ID, with a common value, right? So that is when we can use this. Okay, you can have a user's ID and then you can. So let me restart it. So when I restart it, this is going to drop and recreate the table structure for me because I have added the create drop option of Spring JPI Hibernate to auto create the schema for us for our purpose. So ideally we should not use that in production because it will drop and recreate the whole table structure. So don't try this. There's an exclamatory mark. Okay, so the process is up. So if I refresh, the data is empty again. So let me update some data, right? So I'll say Peter. So if you notice here, this has got updated. And let's check the column names, right? If you notice, the users table has user ID column and users contact has only ID column, right? And let's say if you want to create a different column name. So let's say you want to retain the user's ID in the user's contact itself. You can go ahead and modify here itself. So you can go ahead and say, I want user underscore ID. What will happen is Spring will automatically create another column. So Hibernate will automatically create another column and use that as a relationship. So this ID will be specific to our column with specific to our table called users contact, and this user ID will be a new column which will be used for referencing users table. So basically that will be used as a primary key. Basically it is a foreign key. So primary key on this table would be the ID, and users ID, user ID would be a foreign key. Most of the time it happens, right? You have a table with that kind of data structure. So let's try that out as well. So let me restart the process. So our table got created. So let's go and check the schema definition. If you see here, a new column called user ID got created, because that is the column which we'll be using for linking with the users table, so that the primary key of this particular table is separate and we have a separate foreign key that will be used for our linking with the users table. Okay, now let's do update of Peter. It's getting added. Yeah. If you notice here, these are getting added, and we have a clear definition of how to link a foreign key with the another table. So if you see the content, yeah, the content has got updated, right? So that is how you use a different column to map from this table to other table, which is a foreign key. So this is the foreign key relationship. This is how you link a foreign key with the primary key of another table. Okay. So that's it for this particular video. So in the next video, I will meet you with one to many mapping, and same way with many to one. Let's say in the next video, I'll push this particular code sample into GitHub again. So I'll give the link for the description, link for the GitHub in the description below. So go ahead and try it out. Let me know if you face any issues or something. Comment, like, and subscribe to my channel. And let me know if you want to me to do any specific video on any specific topic, because this particular video also I'm doing based on user suggestions. So go ahead and drop me some comments. I will go ahead and try it out, try something new. If I knew, I will try to share my information. Okay, hope you found it useful. Meet you again in the next video. Thank you.